This is the Skeptic Squared Podcast,
a safe place to make light of sacred things.
My name is Matt.
And I'm Corinne.
And in this program, we will be discussing current events related to religion, atheism, and skepticism. Our goal is not to insult believers,
although that will probably happen from time to time,
but rather to share our point of view on these topics in a way which will benefit and entertain others.
Or maybe we just want to stroke our own egos. You decide.
Hello and welcome to the Skeptic Squared Podcast. Today is Sunday, September 25th, 2016. And with me is my wife, Corinne.
Hello.
How are you doing?
I'm fine.
Yeah?
Yeah.
You've been really, really busy.
I have been really, really busy.
So we haven't recorded much recently because Corinne is actually going through a master's program.
Yay!
And she constantly has lots of homework.
Constantly. So. It's never ending.
Yeah, so our recording time has been significantly reduced, and we'll just kind of do them whenever we can. We happen to have some time today, so we're doing it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, we are.
Yeah.
We're doing it.
So today, we decided that we would do a movie review of another Mormon movie.
Yay!
One which both Corinne and I watched while we were active in the church, and then we watched it again last night. And so we'll be talking a little bit about the whole change in perspective thing, about being active believers, watching a movie about Mormons, and then not being active believers, watching the same movie and all that. And the movie that we're doing is called The Singles Ward, which anybody who knows anything about BYU, Brigham Young University, knows that there are just tons and tons of single people there.
Tons.
And that one of the big parts of the culture there is their singles wards. So they're congregations designated specifically for single people to go and meet other single Mormons and hopefully hook up and have their little Mormon families for eternity.
Yep.
So that's kind of the idea behind them. And so there's a lot of quirkiness that goes with that kind of culture, that mentality. And so this movie sought to lampoon a lot of the aspects of that quirkiness. And in some ways, it actually got quite a few things right. But at the same time, because it's a Mormon movie, exposes things about Mormon culture and about Mormon doctrine that are kind of insidious. That a lot of Mormons, believing Mormons, and you know myself included at the time, didn't really notice as insidious.
Right.
So hopefully, we'll get into that.
Mm-hmm.
So I thought it would be fun to read the IMDb description.
Okay.
I just thought, I'll just read it.
Yeah.
So again, this is the singles ward. When Jonathan Jordan gets divorced, he's thrust back into the world of being a single Mormon, a world whose ultimate goal is eternal marriage. Struggling to fit in, Jonathan decides to stop going to church only to be pursued by members of the local singles ward who want to reactivate him. Nothing works until Jonathan falls for Cammy Giles, the ward activities director. Suddenly, going to church becomes much more appealing. But is he going for the right reasons? Dun dun dun.
No.
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 Short answer is no.
Yeah.
Yeah. Although, from a non-believer's perspective, any reason is not really a good reason to go to church, unless you're, like, studying it out and trying to decide if there's actually any evidence, and then finding out that there's no evidence, so, you know, stop going kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
But at least that was me. Anyway, so, the movie starts out with a scrapbook opening credits, which I thought was...
It's so fitting.
So fitting, because...
Right off the bat, we've got the stereotype.
Yeah. Well, I never went to the Young Woman's program where they actually teach you how to do scrapbooking.
For obvious reasons.
Right, because I wasn't a female. and so for me, like, scrapbooking was always just a little weird. Like, it was fine. Like, it's sort of like crocheting or quilting, you know, sort of an artsy, crafty sort of thing that Mormon girls do. But I never really put much stock into it. And then I went to BYU, and all of these girls around me were doing scrapbooking and, like, spending so much time and money on
these, so much
these,
money.
Yeah, these books that they're doing. And the thing that really irked me about that was the fact that they would use it as an opportunity to condemn me for playing video games.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, well, video games are just such a waste of time, and you can't do this, and nobody can, like, appreciate your work, whereas scrapbooking, people can see what you do, it's so much better, and all that kind of thing. Yeah, but I just don't like scrapbooking. It's not interesting to me, you know. A pastime doesn't need to be something that you showcase to other people, you know.
Yeah, but I think the reason why they showcase it to other people, scrapbooking comes from the idea of keeping a journal.
Right.
And Mormons are very encouraged to keep a journal, and scrapbooking is just another way to keep a journal. It's just a photo journal.
Right.
And so rather than just having a photo album, girls and women go through great lengths to make these cute and, like, almost interactive, and, like, that's what it is. It's a
right.
It's a photo journal that they can share with their posterity.
Yeah. It I don't know. And again, it comes with kind of the culture that Mormonism and BYU breeds, that, you know, there are acceptable things to do, mm-hmm. and there are unacceptable things to
right.
do. And the line is sometimes muddy, but, you know, people find reasons like, well, you can show this, or it's artistic, and therefore it's better than, you know, waste of time activities like video games and movies
right.
and TV shows and that kind of stuff. Unless, of course, those video games and movies and TV shows are uplifting,
right.
you know.
Educational.
Right.
Educational video games are okay.
Yeah.
But only in moderation.
Yeah.
But well, scrapbooking is so expensive. Like, if you take in the financial aspect of scrapbooking versus... Oh, yeah.
Mm.
I mean, you've been to a craft store with me before.
That's
like,
true, yeah.
I mean, the paper alone is really expensive, especially if you go for the cutesy stuff.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and all of the embellishments and stuff. Like, it adds up fast.
Yeah. But hey.
But it's also something that women can do together. Like, it's a great social activity for them. Where, you know, they can interact with each other while still creating something nice for their families.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that's part of the reason why it caught on really well in the Mormon culture.
Yeah, and I remember my mom doing similar kinds of things with her Relief Society groups. Because, you know, once a week, or is it once a month? I can't remember with Relief Society. Is it once a month?
For a Relief Society activity?
Yeah.
Generally, I think they do have one every Thursday, but they have, like, bigger activities like once a month.
Okay.
It kind of depends on the area you're in.
I just have a hard time remembering, because with youth, it's very important that you go to the weekly activities, and
yeah.
there's a ton of them for kids.
It's not as stressed with the women to go.
Right. And so I don't remember my mom going as often as we would go to, like, scouting or
right.
young men's, young women's, mm-hmm. that kind of stuff.
Relief Society was set aside for every Thursday. So there were supposed
okay.
to be activities on Thursdays every night for,
mm-hmm.
or every week for Relief Society activities. But, I mean, they weren't always big affairs.
Yeah. But the times that my mom did go, I do remember her coming back with, you know, lots of artsy, crafty kind of
mm-hmm.
things, you know.
Yeah, stuff like that was once a month.
Yeah. Like, they get, like... like those things that are really popular at Hobby Lobby with, like, the wood cutouts of words, or, like, little cutesy children and that kind of stuff.
They paint them, and
have some kind of Mormon positive message on
mm-hmm.
it, like that kind of thing. So it just reminds me of that.
Yep.
You know, it's like, it's fine, but let's not pretend that it's any more productive than other
right.
activities. You know?
Yeah.
Anyway, so after the opening credits, we meet our protagonist, Jonathan Jordan.
It's a nice name.
Yeah, just
at least
nice
they didn't go
it.
For a stereotypical Mormon name.
No, we get those later.
Yeah.
What were his were they his roommates or just his neighbors? I could never
just
quite tell.
Neighbors.
Okay, because they acted like his roommates, but
yeah,
these
they
three
were just
guys
over there all the time.
Yeah, there are these three guys that we'll talk about a little bit more later, who are all named after prominent Mormons. It's like.
Dallin
and Hiram. I forget what the other guy's name is.
Eldon.
Yeah. They're all like Mormon apostles and prophets.
Mm-hmm.
So that's
yeah.
a thing.
Yeah. And that is very much a real thing.
Yeah, exactly. Which I guess is fine. It's just, it's
yeah.
funny.
Yeah. I mean, the thing that needs to be understood with the movie is that it tried to put every single Mormon stereotype in one movie.
Right.
And so it addresses
which is
a
great
lot
idea.
Of stereotypes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
From that perspective, I like this movie.
Mm-hmm.
That from the fact that they're attempting really hard to laugh at themselves.
Right.
which I think is healthy. Mm-hmm. And I don't think nearly enough Mormons do that.
Right.
And we'll get into that a little bit later. I found some comments from the IMDb page that we'll be talking about where some Mormons are not as thrilled about this movie.
Right.
Let's see. So Jonathan Jordan is an inactive Mormon. He's got a quick wit. He's smart. He's attractive in an almost not douchey kind of way. Yeah, it's a fine accurate line, right?
Yeah.
Like, you know, he just comes across as like the smart aleck kind of pretentious sort.
Yeah,
you know?
He's kind of cocky. He's got an arrogant personality.
Yeah. Which I guess works for a male lead, but
yeah.
it is a stereotype. He goes on a mission, and then he gets married immediately after.
He's doing all the things that the church expects him to do. He makes a point a few times to say that.
Yes. And as I wrote down, like a good Mormon boy should.
Yes.
And then he gets divorced after his convert wife goes off the deep end. So he walks in on her with, you know, smoking cigarettes and open beer cans. And
with her leg draped over the chair. She's just like all slouched over. Right. Like,
and just before that, he finds, was it four cans of a six pack in the fridge? And he's like totally confused by it. And he finds her like that.
Honey?
Yeah. and she says, I don't know if I believe the church is true anymore. To which he replies, but it's Ward Temple night.
Which comes back around at the end of the movie.
I thought that was kind of funny.
It is kind of funny.
just his way of not really understanding the situation or the gravity of it. And blowing it off is like, well, we have our routine and obligations to the church that we still have to do, even if you don't believe, you know? I mean, why should disbelief be a problem?
I'm not sure that's exactly the message the movie was going for, but it's poignant.
Right. And then, you know, in his, you know, description of what happened to her and how she went off the deep end, he gives the example of the boiling frog, right? Which they actually show a frog boiling. So that was fun.
Super fun.
But for those who don't know, I don't know anybody who doesn't, but, you know, the idea is if you put a frog in boiling water, it'll jump out. But if you put a frog in lukewarm water and then raise the temperature gradually to a boil, the frog won't notice, and so he'll just die.
Mm-hmm.
And so he uses that as an example of how sin works, how it's slow and incremental, and it builds and builds and builds, right? There's lots of scriptures in the Book of Mormon that illustrate that idea.
Mm-hmm.
And I wrote down how funny this was because this is just after he finds his wife drinking and smoking just out of the blue because of her sudden disbelief.
Right.
So
yeah,
where was her incremental sliding off the edge?
Okay. So I think this is them saying she never really believed in the church to begin with, which is a common argument for Mormons to use against people that disaffect from the church. It's like, well, they never really believed it anyway, you know. Implying that it's the true church, and if you leave it, then you never really believed it.
The no true Scotsman thing.
Yeah, the no true Scotsman thing. And I think that's what they were showing with her.
Which is interesting, because later in the movie, when he has his epiphany moment, they kind of imply that before that, he never really believed either. But we'll get to that.
Okay.
The scene in the car.
Right. Later. I don't know. Okay, we'll get to it later.
Anyway,
get to it now. I don't understand what you're saying.
So you're saying that the wife was a convert and she left the church because she never really believed it.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. He has his epiphany moment where he realizes that the church actually is true and that he needs to recommit to the church.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. He has that in the car. It's later in the movie.
Right.
That implies to me that before that moment, he also didn't really know that the church was true. That's why he wasn't so committed.
Oh, you know? Okay. Yeah. No, I can see that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Everybody needs that moment, right? Going to the church.
Yeah.
Which I guess is true, but the...
Well, the church likes to say that every member needs to be a convert.
Right.
You know, it's like you need to have that conversion moment where you know with a surety that the church is true. Mm-hmm. You can't just go through building your testimony on the testimony of others.
Right.
And okay. That light, I definitely see where you're coming
from. Which is probably what they were trying to say with the wife doing with his testimony. Which is a common thing for them to say.
Yeah. I mean, she joined the church because she loved him and wanted to marry him, and the only way she could do that is if she converted.
Right.
Yeah.
Which also, very common.
So super common.
Anyway. Let's see.
So he starts spiraling out of control. He does his, you know, gradual sinning.
Oh, yeah. You want to explain that?
So there's a lovely montage of him going to the grocery store, picking out some hard tea. It's not even beer. It's just tea.
Right.
Six-pack of tea. And then he goes to the BYU movie rental place. Is that a real place?
Yeah. It used to be.
Okay.
They closed it down while I was at BYU. So when this movie was made in, was it 97? This would have been a very popular
thing. This movie was 2002. Remember?
Where am I getting 97?
You're getting 97 from the movie we watched the other
night. That's right, yeah. Alien Resurrection.
Alien Resurrection.
Yeah. Well, that's right. So in 2002, though, that was right when I got home from my mission.
Mm-hmm.
So it still would have been a thing then as well. Right. But it's called, it was called Cougar Video, I think.
Oh, right.
And the idea was that they would edit R-rated movies.
Oh, this
and
is
take
where
out
the idea
the bad
of
stuff.
Came from, right?
Yeah, exactly. Clean flicks. And they would edit out all the bad stuff so that good, clean Mormons could watch the good, clean versions of these R-rated movies without all the bad stuff in it.
Right.
And so what were the movies that he rented?
Well, so Jonathan says that he starts to do all the things that the church told him not to do. So he goes to the Cougar Video and he rents like Nightmare on Elm Street, like 1 through 5.
Oh, yeah, Freddy Krueger.
Mm-hmm. Then he rents Die Hard 1 through 3.
Yeah.
And The Newsies? and Halloween.
Okay. Yeah.
So then, you know, we see him sitting on his couch drinking his tea.
Right.
And I guess, like, watching a movie, and then he also calls his cable subscription and says, hey, I've got MTV blocked, and I need you to unblock it.
Right.
You know? So he starts going hardcore, and then he makes the point of saying as much as Provo would allow him.
Right.
Which I think is funny, too.
Absolutely. And that's the joke, is that when Mormons go off the deep end, they end up doing incredibly mild things a lot of the time, you know.
Which is actually kind of interesting, because I think a lot of time people think, like Mormons think, that people that leave the church or go through a rebellious phase automatically switch to doing, you know, like hard liquor and smoking and sleeping around.
And,
it is kind of interesting that he actually gradually gets to that point versus just automatically switching.
Right. And there are people that do that. But
I think that's more common.
More common.
To gradually work your way.
Yeah, exactly. Because there's a ton of baggage. Like, just because you stop believing doesn't mean that you are comfortable doing all of the things that that were prohibited by the religion. You know, it's like the example that I've given before was Salman Rushdie, the author, right?
Mm-hmm.
And when he described his I guess, atheist enlightenment, when he realized that he didn't actually believe in God. He was raised Muslim. And he had this moment where he decided that he was going to eat a ham sandwich. Because in Islam, you can't eat pork. Okay, and so he decided that he was going to eat a ham sandwich to kind of test God, just test the waters of his disbelief, right? And he goes and gets a ham sandwich, he eats it, and he's not terribly impressed by it. It's kind of bland, it's not very tasty, he doesn't really like it, but the important thing about it was that he wasn't struck down. It wasn't like this huge immoral thing that he had just done. It was just this mundane everyday thing that his old religion prohibited, and so he just kind of used that as like his stepping off point for like, well, I guess it's not that bad being an unbeliever, you know. And it's the same kind of thing with a lot of Mormons, where they just kind of gradually start saying bad words or start watching PG-13 and then R-rated movies and, you know, that kind of stuff. And, you know, a lot of people do end up getting to things like drugs and alcohol and stuff like that. But not everybody does. I mean, you and I haven't, you know. And there's no reason why you necessarily would. Because there are plenty of reasons not to do those things. And there's plenty of reasons.
Legitimate scientific reasons.
Right. And there are plenty of reasons to not suppose that doing those things are necessarily bad.
Right.
You know, if you can drink moderately and keep it within a healthy medium, you know, why not?
Yeah, if you're not causing harm to anyone else.
Yeah. Exactly.
Why not?
I forgot where we were within the storyline. So he's so, going yeah, off the he, deep end.
So we go. Yeah, we have to show his backstory a little bit as to how he got to the point that he's at right now. Well, I guess so. The movie opens up with him waking up to his phone ringing, and he answers it. He's all, you know, sleepy or whatever. And on the other end is the new ward activities director.
Right.
Who has discovered that Jonathan Jordan is a stand-up comedian and is hoping to enlist him to volunteer in helping with the Ward talent show.
Right.
So that he'll just give his abilities, you know.
Right. And which is totally typical of Mormons.
Completely typical. It's like...
Yeah.
Yeah. They always solicit, you know, members to use their, you know, hobbies and work abilities to help, like...
It's part of the temple ceremony. And stuff. It's part of the temple ceremony. You commit your time, money, and talents to the church. That's where they get that from.
Okay.
And so, within Mormonism, there's this idea that if you have a talent, that's God giving you that talent so that you can benefit the church and uplift the church and bring people into the church.
Okay.
That's where that comes from.
Okay, that makes sense.
Yeah. And so that's what she's doing.
Yes, and that's what she's doing. And he responds in his, you know... Snarky way by saying, well, what do you do for a living? And she happens to work with like elderly people at a care facility.
Right.
He's like, oh, then are you going to come over and feed me tapioca pudding and change my sheets and give me a sponge bath? You know, basically implying like you're wanting me to, you know, to give me your my livelihood
for free for the church.
For the church. It's like,
yeah. So why don't you do some reciprocity? Thing for me?
Yeah, so do the same thing for me. She gets all huffy, hangs up on him, yada, yada, yada.
Right.
And then we meet his three friends.
Right. So a couple of these guys are just totally obsessed with Mormon celebrities, which kind of becomes a running gag. Like, did you know that this person was a Mormon? Did you know that this person wasn't a Mormon? Mm-hmm. This person was a Mormon and isn't a Mormon anymore? And all that kind of thing. It's just funny because it's... you know, it's kind of tapping into that idea. We've talked about this before with Mormon celebrities, where Mormons will use that as a way of legitimizing their religion through popular culture, which is exactly what Scientologists do when they point to Tom Cruise and John Travolta. Mm-hmm. You know, it's the same thing. It's like, we're not as fringe as you might think. Look at all of these famous people that also think that we're real.
Right. But quite often they overlook the fact that most of these celebrities have actually left the church.
True.
Like Aaron Eckhart and Amy Adams are really good examples of that.
Mm-hmm.
But,
exactly.
Yeah. So yeah, Dallin is the one that is really into it. He calls out Lionel Richie. He says that he's a member of the church. Said Walter Matthau and his wife had their mission papers in just before Walter died. Or some of the other ones. Was he tracked it into Bruce Willis.
Yeah, at the end of his mission. Yeah. Was he the one that shared the story about the three Nephites?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. Which is another really funny thing that we've talked about.
Mm-hmm.
This sort of urban Mormon legend of these three guys in the Book of Mormon who were alive when Jesus came to America, right? And they wanted to continue to serve mankind rather than die.
Okay. Right.
So they wanted to be missionaries, basically. And so he, Jesus, grants them immortality, okay, essentially, and tells them that they will never taste death until Jesus returns again. So they're essentially just wandering around the land being missionaries for ancient Mormonism, I guess,
or
whatever. And so there's lots of these stories of three big, strong Native American guys showing up and helping people change their tire on the side of the road and then disappearing right afterwards.
They're never usually described as Native Americans, though. Three men.
Mm. I guess that's...
I've never heard it three big Native American men. I've heard three big men, usually with the implication that they're white.
Which I guess would make sense because if they were Nephites, they would still be white.
Exactly.
According to the Book of Mormon.
Yeah.
White Native Americans.
Yep.
So that's fun.
Yeah.
but it's just, you know, it's just an urban legend that pops up in Mormon culture all the time. Right. And so they kind of poke fun at that, which is kind of funny.
Right. Yeah. So Dallin is obsessed with figuring out what celebrities are Mormons. And he's also very steeped in Mormon lore.
Yeah.
And then there's Eldon, who is tall, skinny, geek.
Yeah.
And is obsessed with planners.
Yeah, like day planners and palm pilots and all of that kind of stuff.
Yeah, like most of his conversations with girls revolve around the type of planners that they use.
Yeah. which at BYU in 2003 when I was there, so a year after this movie came out, was kind of a thing.
Really?
Yeah. So yeah, it's just funny, like, the way that they poke fun at that kind of stuff. Because that doesn't even really have anything to do with Mormonism or Mormon culture. It's just they're geeks at college being geeks, you know?
They just needed another stereotype.
Yeah.
And then there's Hiram, who doesn't really do anything, but he believes everything Dallin says. He's just kind of a goofball.
Just gullible. Yeah. And just silly. Yeah. He actually reminds me a lot of one of the missionaries in God's Army that we did a review on.
The blonde guy?
Yeah.
Yeah.
The prankster guy?
Yeah.
He reminds me a lot of him.
But Hiram comes off as being kind of unintelligent. Actually, Dallin is too. Yeah. But...
yeah.
Basically, Jonathan's the most normal person.
Which is funny.
Yeah.
So some of the ways in which the ward tries to reactivate Jonathan, I thought were kind of fun. Remember that montage?
Oh, yeah.
So they have
there are lots of montages in this movie.
Lots and lots of montages. They have the people show up with the barbecue. Mm-hmm. Just with plates of barbecue.
We were having a barbecue, but you might like some chicken.
And the paintball team, right? We're looking for another player.
Another player.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. The Relief Society showing up with cheesecake.
It wasn't just Relief Society, though. There were two guys there, too. It was like a ward activity to make.
I didn't see the guys.
The very last shot of the person holding up a cheesecake with this weird face and, like, does a wink. That's a guy.
Oh, yeah. No, I do remember that. But it's just funny because that sort of thing is really common within Mormonism, but it's amplified at BYU because everybody lives in these close-knit apartment complexes. Mm-hmm. And so everybody lives really close to each other. So when they have a ward activity, they really can just go door-to-door around the complex and say, hey, we're doing this. You want to join us?
Yeah.
Like, they can do it.
I think it's interesting that Jonathan still lives in Provo, considering he graduated from BYU already.
Right.
Like, why he didn't even move one city over.
It's more common than you'd think.
The BYU bubble.
It's more common than you'd think. A lot of people like the culture. They like the fact that everybody there believes like they do. And a lot of people are still looking to get married. And so that's a good place to be to find somebody to marry.
Right. But he comes across as not looking for any of that.
Oh, but it's subconscious.
He's, I mean, really, that's why really in the movie he is still there. But I think in real life, a person like Jonathan Jordan wouldn't actually be there. He would stay in Utah. I have no doubt of that. But, like, moving to Salt Lake makes a lot more sense. And he commutes to Salt Lake. Like, that's where he does his stand-up.
Yeah.
Like, it doesn't make sense that he lives in Provo.
Yeah.
But that's beside the point.
Mm-hmm. A few other quick side notes. All of the music in this is just various pop rock versions of the church's children's songs.
There are actually a couple towards the end that are not primary songs.
Oh, I missed those. And I wrote as my note here, which means there is a large segment of the music scene in Utah which does this with a straight face.
Yeah. That's so true.
Because they were all different artists. I actually have the soundtrack. I got it while I was at BYU because we were somebody had it and we needed it for a video that we were making for some ward activity. We were going to use some of the music from this movie. And so I have it. And it's all like each of the songs are done by different groups, which means that there are at least that many groups in Utah that do this.
That's funny.
There are also lots of jokes about really fast engagements.
Yeah.
They give one example of... I didn't get the exact wording down, but it was something like this. So Jim and Patty are getting married after meeting on the ward hike. And then somebody replies, really? I just took her to the dance. You know.
Yeah. I think that was actually Jonathan that says that. It's like, really? I just took her to homecoming a week ago.
Yeah. But that kind of thing happens all the time at BYU. Yeah. Like people are getting hooked up super, super fast because they have this idea that if they are worthy and the person that they are dating is worthy, they can make their marriage work out. And so so all of these things that normal people would have to kind of hash through the whole courting process and dating process, Mormons just kind of skip ahead to the end because they just assume that they're on the same page on all of these things. Mm-hmm. You know, they got all the Mormon stuff done. They're actively trying to get a job and trying to get a good career. They probably want a decent-sized family. And, you know, like, there's lots of shortcuts that Mormonism provides within their framework. The problem, though, is that a lot of people just buy into it without really thinking, is this really what I want? And so that is where a lot of the problems come in.
Right.
And a lot of people end up getting divorced after a year or two, yeah, or 5 years or whatever, because they just can't make it work because they weren't ready to get married to begin with.
Right. You know? Right. I think it's because the church prioritizes marriage material a lot differently than the world does.
Yeah.
And like, just thinking back on my experiences in Young Women's, when they would make us write out lists of what we wanted, like ideal attributes of our spouse, would be like, the top one always had to be worthy priesthood holder. Mm-hmm. The second one was inevitably return missionary.
Right.
Anything other than that fell far below that. So, you know, funny, smart, intelligent, you know, like
similar sense of humor.
Yeah. Similar sense of like humor. The same kind of
movies.
Those things aren't taken into consideration.
Mm-hmm.
Personalities, people think personalities are going to be the same because you think, I want an eternal family, and so everything's going to work out.
Right.
And it doesn't.
Yeah, shortcuts don't work.
No.
Yeah. And I think that's where a lot of the strain comes for a lot of these early young Mormon couples, you know, that just get married super young.
Mm-hmm.
You know. Anyway, that's a whole thing.
Yeah, that's a whole other podcast.
That's a whole other thing.
Right.
But it's a very important part of this movie and what they're trying to lampoon.
Mm-hmm.
Because, again, they're making fun of that. They're making fun of the fact that people get married super fast.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, but they never say what would be an acceptable time frame.
Right.
They just make fun of the fact that people get married after a couple weeks or a couple months.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, back to the story.
Back to the story.
Jonathan drives Dallin, Eldon, and Hiram to a steak dance.
Yes. Lots of dances in this.
I hate steak dances.
But it was kind of funny, though. It's like in...
It is funny.
It's like in Napoleon Dynamite.
Yeah. My gosh, it totally is.
Yeah, it is.
It's Napoleon Dynamite.
It's Napoleon Dynamite. Yeah, the high school dance with like the puffy dresses and the cheesy music and stuff and just poor decorations and a gym.
Yep.
You know, like that's what it is. That's their dances.
Yep.
And that's exactly what BYU dances are.
Right.
Unless they're actually on campus and they can rent out one of the big ballrooms. But then it's just that, but with thousands of people.
Right.
So, and loud music.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway.
So, yeah, Jonathan takes him to the steak dance. He's supposed to have a private gig that night, so his plan is just to drop them off. But he gets a page. Yes, he uses a beeper.
Uh-huh.
He gets a page that, you know, says that he needs to call this number or whatever. So he calls the number, finds out that the gig has been canceled. And so now he's like, oh, great, what do I do?
Right.
So he goes out, tries to start his car. His car, for some reason, just decides not to work anymore. And so now he's stuck at the steak dance.
Which happens at very inopportune moments without this movie.
Yeah. Yeah. It's like God's hand reaching down, saying, stop, you need to meet this woman.
Oh, no, you're forcing me to do things by making my life mildly inconvenient.
Right. So he's annoyed. He's out in the, oh my gosh, what's it called?
The foyer.
Foyer.
Yeah.
He's or out in foyer. The foyer.
If you want to be pretentious
about it.
We're
Mormon, it's foyer.
It's foyer.
and he's just sitting there. Another thing that this movie does is brings in a lot of famous Mormons, like actual Mormons.
Right.
Like in this scene, the guy that's in the movie, Charlie, is reading the book Charlie.
Oh, I forgot about that one. Yeah.
Which Mormons get a huge kick out of this scene.
Right, because that's a Mormon movie.
It's a Mormon movie. Yeah. It's a Mormon author that wrote it.
Yeah. But is the movie itself explicitly Mormon, or is it more generic?
I've never seen Mormon.
It is explicit?
Yeah, they talk about the church.
Okay.
The main character, Sam, converts Charlie, marries her, yada, yada, yada.
Okay. But it's a super sad love story. Ends with a death, right?
She dies.
She dies, yeah. And the guy, the actor in the movie, is reading the book in this movie.
And is at that part where she dies and is crying.
Yeah.
I mean, it's funny. Like, being LDS and understanding these things, it is actually pretty funny.
Yeah. And there's a few of those kinds of moments that we'll get to a little bit later as well.
But this is the first big one.
Yeah. And so this is where we find out, or we meet Cammie, the female lead.
Mm-hmm.
And she tries to get him to go to like the main part of the dance and eat food and blah, blah, blah.
In such a witty way.
Cause they have such great chemistry together, you know? And then later in the evening, we find out that she's the ward activities director that was calling him on the phone that he was super rude to. But he totally likes her because she's totally hot. And so what does he do?
He lies to her.
He lies to her because that's the reasonable thing to do.
Yeah. My name is John John because my parents are Democrats in a very Republican state. It's like, for a witty guy, he's kind of stupid sometimes.
Right. Anyway, so basically what this all amounts to is that he decides that he's going to start going to church so that he can hit on her.
Yeah.
Which is fun. And totally a thing that happens.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. And it becomes a lot more apparent that that's happening in both directions a little bit later in the movie.
Yeah.
Another
stereotype in that steak dance is Jell-O.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, you don't ever see the Jell-O, but a girl slips into Jell-O.
Mm.
Yeah. Sorry, I think she scratched her retina on a carrot. Again, one of those moments that is hilarious if you understand the stereotypes in this movie.
So the stereotype is that Mormons really like green Jell-O with shredded carrots in them.
Yeah, for some reason, that's like a Mormon food staple.
Right, and so...
Although, I've never eaten it.
And stuff. Really?
I have never had green Jell-O with shredded carrots. But I also don't really like
it. It tastes exactly as you'd expect.
Like green Jell-O with shredded carrots?
Yes. That's exactly what it tastes like. Anyway, so it's just funny that she trips into one of these vats of green Jell-O with shredded carrots and scratches her retina with a carrot.
I thought you slipped on Jell-O. No, I slipped into Jell-O.
That's all I got for the dance.
Yeah.
Oh, wait. No, I do have one more thing. Kind of. This is an overlapping thing. So we meet this guy at this dance.
Deverl.
Who, as it turns out, the actor becomes the most successful actor out of anybody in this movie.
Yeah. Yeah.
He did a lot of stuff with, like, Saints and Soldiers and stuff like that. Anyway, so he's just this socially awkward, off-putting sort of guy, and he hits on every girl and, like, really... again, he's
it's
sort of
borderline
making,
creepy.
It's borderline creepy, but it's also tapping into some of the more... ridiculous aspects of Mormonism.
Yeah, like the spirit telling you what it's telling me.
Yeah, yeah, like that kind of stuff.
I think we met in the pre-existence.
Well, I was just about to get to that one. So at another dance, they have an after party, and he goes with his date. He finds a date there. And
he finds a date at another ward activity. That's,
oh, that's
his
right.
ward activity.
He starts perusing campus
for other activities.
And picks up this girl that has like a one of those big
headgear
braces. And anyway, so he puts his arm around her, and she like holds his hand and all that kind of stuff, and you know that they're meant for each other kind of moment, right? And he says, "I think we met in the pre-existence," and it's just
which taps into the Saturday's Warrior thing, which was the movie they were supposed to be watching but ended up not watching.
Yeah, we'll get to that scene in a minute. So
another thing at the dance that the one girl. So Cammy's two roommates are helping with the snacks and punch and stuff in the kitchen, and they're talking about people that have recently started dating or are engaged, and the one girl, I don't know that we ever learn her name, but she starts talking about what her ideal husband is going to be like, and she does this throughout the entire movie.
Yes, it's a
trope. He's going to be 6'4", weigh 240 pounds, have 6%
body fat. At least a master's degree, a PhD would be nice.
Right, that's later. Yeah. I mean, she goes through the ward phone book and like crosses out people that she doesn't think is worth her time. You know, it's,
which is really funny because she herself is a very average person.
She's an average person, and she's got an obvious eating problem that they never address. She's always eating something. Always.
Yeah. And I wrote down for my note for her. So she has this long list of requirements for her future husband. When I get married, my husband will do this and that and blah, blah, blah. And she uses this as a way of having her husband fix all of her imperfections, which I think is one of those kind of insidious ideas that creeps into this Mormon construct of marriage where you can't be a complete person until you're married.
Yep.
Being married makes you whole.
Mm-hmm.
And she buys into that completely and takes it to the extreme, the logical extreme, right? Like I'm an incomplete person. These are my imperfections. I need to find somebody to counterbalance all of these things that I do wrong so that we'll be perfect together, which I think is an awful idea.
Yeah. But it's still very pervasive.
It is.
Like, the apostles still give talks on stuff like this.
Oh, yeah.
Like, you need a helpmate. You can't be complete without another person. A husband needs a wife. A wife needs a husband. Like,
yeah. It's interesting that you bring up the helpmate idea, because they could have gone the other route of her fulfilling the imperfections of her husband. Like, I need to do this because my husband won't be able to. Like, that kind of thing. I need to be a good cook for my husband. I need to be good at finances for my husband. You know, right.
That would have been a separate movie, though.
Perhaps,
they couldn't spend that time on her.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, they could have tried to do that with Cammy, but Cammy's a level-headed person.
She's very, very condescending.
Yeah. She's not as condescending as the one girl in God's Army was, though.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Cammy's at least coming from the point where she was actually insulted, you know, and so she has a chip on her shoulder because of that.
Whereas the girl in God's Army is all about
being superior, right?
Because the other guy looks like a jock.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Let's see. So we have a few scenes of Jonathan trying to become more active in the church, right? Trying to attend activities and things, and they go to what's called a fireside, or not a fireside, it was FHE, Family Home Evening.
Before that, though, is the Break the Fast.
Oh, yeah, with the lasagna.
He tries to go to the singles ward, but he didn't know that the time switched, and so he ends up at a family ward.
Uh-huh.
Yada, yada, yada.
A few funny jokes in there.
Yeah, but then he goes to the Break the Fast afterwards, which is a pretty typical thing for singles wards to have as well.
Yeah, which is annoying.
Yeah, I actually don't know how... popular that is anymore.
At BYU is pretty popular.
But still, because when I was in the singles ward, they actually kind of cracked down on doing things like linger longers and stuff because it was eating up a bunch of the budget. And they didn't...
Oh, really?
Yeah, there was another reason for that, too. I mean, they still technically do stuff like that, but it's not to the scale that it used to be.
I think okay, so right before I left Provo, what I remember doing with my ward was we would do a Break the Fast potluck with our FHE groups.
So
we would all get together. We'd all bring something together. And it wouldn't be like this huge ward activity. It would be like a dozen people, like in one of the apartments. And you just have a couple people bring entrees, a couple people bring desserts and that kind of stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And you do it that way rather than this big shindig.
Okay.
So the big shindig is probably going away, but they're probably still doing something like that because they love the little social stuff, you know, like anything to get the boys and girls together so they can fall in love.
Yeah.
You know.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
Okay, so there's that scene with the whole lasagna joke going on, which
that's
is
where
kind
we
of funny,
get
but...
the three Nephites story.
Yeah.
And we are introduced to the first and basically the only black man.
Right.
Who points that out.
Yeah. What did he say? He had some joke about a Mormon going to LA and meeting a
black
person
for
the
first
time.
Yeah, I can't remember the first part because he compares it to something that Jonathan had just said.
Right. Anyway, so after that scene, we get a scene at an FHE or a Family Home Evening group. So the idea with that is that it's a little bit more spiritual. It's like church, but on a Monday night. And the original idea of this was to build family unity. But since these are singles, they don't have families of their own, right? And they're out of their parents' home.
But they need to keep this habit, because otherwise they're not going to do it in their families.
Right. And again, it's just another excuse to get the boys and girls together. And in this particular instance, they go to the house of one of the bishopric members, right?
The only bishopric member we ever meet.
Right. Did they ever say if he was the bishop or first counselor or whatever?
They just call him Brother Angel.
Okay. And he gives his little talk or whatever, and then he has this, and Jonathan has his moment with the urn for the dog's ashes that he spills over.
Yeah,
the meet the parents moment, which was kind of funny.
Mm-hmm. Steve Young is also in this scene.
Yes, which is what I wanted to get to.
Mm-hmm.
So Steve Young is a famous Mormon. He played football for BYU and then went on into the NFL and had a very successful career. And there's a few interesting things about Steve Young. One is he didn't go on a mission. He talked to his bishop when he was at mission age. And they decided that he would be more useful to the church
as a football player
rather than being a missionary.
Yep.
And so he did that. instead of going on a mission. And another thing that's interesting about him, especially in reference to this movie specifically, is that he didn't get married until he was in his late 30s.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
I didn't know that.
That's what makes this scene so funny.
Ah, okay. Why the thing that comes out of his mouth next is
exactly
funny.
Okay. So he's a descendant of Brigham Young, who is the second president of the Mormon Church. He's the
half
one that
the Mormon population is probably related to, right, Brigham Young.
Right. And he so Brigham Young gets everybody out to Utah. He's the first really big, well-known polygamist. And Brigham Young very famously said that any man who is not married by the age of 25 is a menace to society. Okay. Mm-hmm. And they're saying this at a singles ward where, mm-hmm, people like Jonathan are, you know, over 25 in their 30s. And although, to Jonathan's credit, he's divorced. So,
yes.
So.
He did get married before 25.
He did. anyway, so it's just really funny. Like he, Steve Young, quoting Brigham Young, his great, 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 great grandfather, mm-hmm, about how he, Steve Young, was a menace to society. and it's
that
sort of this wink and nod kind of thing. And then right after that, they have another scene where Steve Young is talking to one of the guys in, mm-hmm, in the ward.
That's the one with the cheesecake.
Oh, yeah. Okay. And so this guy is just kind of complaining about how hard it is being single. He can never get a date. He's got so much pressure to get married.
He's mostly talking about all the pressure from all the different angles.
Right.
Get married.
Which is totally legit.
Accurate.
Yeah, it's
there
totally
is so
legit.
Much pressure on a single person, mm-hmm, in the Mormon Church,
yep,
to get married. That, yep, is your sole goal.
Yes. And then Brigham or Steve Young is just like, well, that's really hard. I just can't even imagine. I don't even know what to say. And
it's just basically, he doesn't say anything productive and leaves him.
I thought that was a pretty fun scene, given that Steve Young again didn't get married till he was like 39 or whatever. You know,
really, it was that late.
He was that late. Yeah.
Interesting.
Mm-hmm. There were a few other cameos. We get a cameo of Lavelle Edwards, who was the coach for BYU's football team at the time.
Mm-hmm.
And then another really fun cameo of Richard Dutcher,
mm-hmm, who made God's Army.
Who made God's Army and was the leading character in God's Army. So we'll get to that in a little bit.
It's funny that Lavelle Edwards is the only one that was actually himself. Everyone else had a different part. Like, they were actually a character.
That's an interesting point. I didn't even think of that.
Yeah, I literally just thought of that. Hmm. But everyone else, all the other famous people that they bring into the movie, is a different character.
Right, they're just kind of poking fun at themselves.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Which is fine. Like, there's nothing wrong with that, and it makes it funny, but it's just interesting that he's the only one.
Makes you wonder why. Probably because he's a football coach and not an actor. It's
yeah. I mean, given the context of the scene where he comes into, like, it wouldn't really matter if he was a different player. And,
right,
like, or person.
I think also he's not as recognizable.
Yeah, I didn't know it was Lavelle Edwards until you were like, I think that's Lavelle Edwards.
And even I wasn't sure,
right,
until the other guy called him coach.
Coach.
It's like,
yeah.
Okay, yeah, it's Lavelle Edwards.
Right.
Let's see. So we haven't talked about the guy who bungee jumps his car yet.
Oh, yeah.
So he's another one of the friends or roommates or whatever.
I think he might be Eldon's brother.
Really?
I think, but I'm not 100% sure because they don't really address his relationship.
Uh-huh.
But I know he's at least Eldon's roommate.
Okay.
But when I used to watch it,
uh-huh,
I always just kind of assumed that he was their brother.
Okay.
His brother.
And he's an interesting character for a few reasons. One, he's got a ton of tattoos and piercings. He is constantly kind of, sort of getting into legal trouble, right? Being arrested for various things. Usually just hooligan stuff, just messing around with things.
Yeah.
I mean, trying,
he's portrayed as an idiot.
Right. So the example that they give is he tries to attach his car to bungee cables and have it bungee jump off a cliff.
Yeah.
And it goes wrong. It causes a big fire. That's why Jonathan misses that gig.
Mm-hmm.
And so he gets into trouble with that. It's just him just not being a competent person. And I took that as a stereotype of a typical ex-Mormon with no moral compass,
mm-hmm,
right? Just going through life doing whatever. He's got tons of tattoos and piercings, and he's just kind of bleh, whatever, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And he doesn't have his life in order. Like, this is the way that a lot of Mormons view ex-Mormons.
Yes.
But the other interesting thing, going along with what you said about how Jonathan realistically probably wouldn't even live in BYU housing, this guy definitely wouldn't live in BYU housing.
Well, that's kind of why I think maybe I just kind of assumed that he's related to Eldon somehow. And, I mean, he's portrayed as a not intelligent person, so probably incapable of holding down a job or having his own place, so he mooches off of other people. And so in that respect, I think it makes sense that he lives there because it's the one place that he can get a place to live without owing anything, you know? So I kind of see how that would be kind of realistic, but I mean, I get what you're saying, too. It's like, more than likely, he would also be in Salt Lake.
And I don't remember exactly the way that the Honor Code office works and with student housing. I know that there are a ton of rules about what you can and can't do at BYU housing. There's a chance that he would get in trouble for having the look that he has at BYU housing.
Right. But then again, like, they never specifically say that it's BYU housing because it kind of seems like Cammy and Jonathan, like, they all live in the same complex. And usually, aren't they more divided?
At BYU, you can be in the same complex, but you can't be in the same building.
Oh, okay.
At least that's the way it was when I was there.
So they could have been in a different building.
Yeah, or at least not the same floor. But the complex that I lived at the longest, we were separated by buildings.
I guess that's true. The place that I lived before I moved in with you, the one half was girls, and then the next half. I mean, it was all the same building, but it was divided in the middle. So, okay, right. That makes sense.
Yeah, so I'm pretty sure that's how they get away with it. Because, again, you can't have people fraternizing right next door, you know, too many people will get pregnant, and then they'll not get married in the temple.
Right away, anyway. Yeah. They'll have to wait a year.
One other side note that I thought was fun is when what's his name gets his mission called to Boise, Idaho, which he's super excited about, and nobody else is excited about at all.
Well, he's excited about it because he's so stupid he doesn't know where Boise is.
All right. Oh yeah, he doesn't.
Where's a map?
He needs to get a map. But in the back there are Mormon ads.
Yeah.
I thought that was
like,
super funny.
I hope they call me on a mission and stuff like that.
Like, so Mormon ads were these things that were in, what was it, the New Era, which is one of the church's magazines for youth. Yeah. And they have these little pictures with captions. It was basically a meme before memes were a thing. Just promoting Mormonism and Mormon ideals and stuff. Mm-hmm. And they try to be a little bit clever. Like one of the ones that I remember really well is they have a picture of a big scoop of ice cream with a cockroach in it. Mm-hmm. And it says something like, it was all really good except for this one part. Right. You know, like talking about like going to an R-rated movie. Is it, you know, is it really worth it? Because sure, like most of it's really good, like ice cream, but there's that one really bad part, like a cockroach. Do you really want to eat the cockroach? Mm-hmm. You know, that kind of stuff. You know, just funny.
Send an email is a popular one.
Oh, yeah.
That one, I think, is actually in my brother's bathroom. I think my mom put that up there.
Yeah, it's just really common in Mormonism.
Yeah.
There's the cop show.
The Fuzz. Again, everyone is just kind of an idiot in this movie, except for the main characters.
Right.
And, the two main characters.
Right. So they have this funny scene where the Fuzz, it's a spoof on the show Cops.
Mm-hmm.
And they're following around the Provo police, who have nothing better to do than to arrest Cammy for breaking into her own apartment with her own laundry.
Yeah.
And so, and it's funny, like I was trying to think of examples of the Provo police that I've had, you know, interactions that I've had with them. And I actually thought of one that was kind of along the same lines.
Oh, really?
Yeah. I think I told you about this. So in my ward at the time, we were, one of the big activities that we would do every year is we would make FHE videos. Okay. So each FHE group would make a video, and then we'd have like our own little, you know, Oscar night, and we'd screen the movies and give awards. I mean, it was fun. And so everybody was making their movies, right, for like a couple months before we were going to have our big event. And one of the groups had, what were they doing? They were doing some spoof on like Back to the Future or something, and you know, in Back to the Future when they're being chased by the Libyans, Mm-hmm. And, like, they're shooting guns back and forth, and it's, like, this crazy scene, right? And so they're trying to recreate that in the parking lot. Oh, my gosh. Okay. That's funny. and so they got, like, a couple of guys, you know, hanging out of, like, the door windows and, like, trying to shoot fake guns at each other and, like, just driving super slow, just around a circle, like, around one of the buildings. And some lady was just walking her dog, like, by this, and she thought that it was a legitimate shootout. Okay. And so she called the cops. She said that there was a shootout at this apartment complex and they're just driving around in circles shooting each other. And so I'm in my apartment, like at my computer, and I'm probably playing video games or something, and I hear this commotion going on outside my window. And so I look out the window and I see the two cars of the guys in my ward, like, driving, right? And they're stopped in the middle of the parking lot. And on one side you have two cop cars, and on the other side of the parking lot you have another cop car, and you have, like, six cops with, like, their hands on their holsters, like, get out of the car, put down the, you know.
Oh my gosh.
It's like, is this for real?
That's,
like,
so funny.
So yeah, it happens.
That's funny.
Yeah, it's just ridiculous. Anyway, they were toy guns. There wasn't even a shot.
Yeah, that is so funny. She thinks it's a shootout, and it's not even like legit gun noises.
Yeah, did you not see the person, like, with the camera, like, filming this?
That's interesting.
And then, like stopping and, like, doing multiple takes and, like do this, do this, and, like, there not actually being any gunshots. Like,
right.
Like what about this actually screams shootout?
That's so funny.
So that's my experience with the Provo police.
Let's see. Oh, we should go back a little bit.
Okay.
Just point out some other stereotypes. So another mm-hmm. stereotype is Mormon Standard Time. And this comes up in the FHE scene.
Yeah.
Where Jonathan decides to go to FHE, but he doesn't want to sit through all the spiritual stuff. And so he goes 45 minutes late, mm-hmm. but forgot to adjust for Mormon Standard Time.
Right.
And Mormon Standard Time, as the joke goes, is like you add 25 minutes onto whatever time a Mormon tells you to be somewhere.
Right. Because the idea is that Mormons have such big families that it takes them forever to actually get anywhere. Yeah. So they're always 25 minutes late.
Nothing ever starts on time.
So nothing ever starts.
Except for church.
Yeah, but even then...
But like, it always goes late.
People trickle in
yeah.
for like 30 minutes and then it runs late. And
right. Yeah. But they don't wait. Anyway, so that was a stereotype I wanted to point out. And mm-hmm. then, let's see, there was... Oh... Eldon, before they go to, what's it called? Break the Fast, I think.
Okay.
Oh, no, it's while Jonathan is getting his car fixed. Eldon mm-hmm. is there with him, and Jonathan is, like, lamenting why it's so hard to get Cammy to, like, go out with him.
Oh.
And Eldon points out that Jonathan is used to meeting women in the world, like at bars and stuff.
Oh, yeah.
And that women like Cammy, who are Mormon, are a lot different.
Right. They have higher standards.
They have higher standards.
Yeah, because women at bars are so easy to pick up on.
Right. All that. Well, Jonathan says, you know, he's right. Like, picking up a woman at a bar, like, the expectation is I'm going to hang out with you for 2 or 3 hours.
Right.
But a Mormon woman looks at you and... weighs you in regards to time and all eternity.
Right.
So if they're not willing, like, right off the bat to spend the rest of their lives and eternity with you, then they just kind of forget about you.
So it's not just, are you worth my time? It's are you worth my time and eternity?
Exactly. Which, again, is fairly accurate.
It is
in a way.
A certain type of Mormon girl. But there are lots of Mormon kids, boys and girls, that are fine with just hanging out with somebody.
Yeah.
Just going to a party or whatever.
Especially now.
Yeah, like they still have that in the back of their mind. Mm-hmm. Like, do I really want to marry this person in the long run? Yeah. Like, is this a marriageable person?
Right.
That
usually doesn't happen until after the first date, though.
Right.
Like, do I go out with this person again? Do I really see myself being able to marry this person?
Right.
Okay, I'll go out on a second date.
Yeah.
It's like, this is a conversation that they have internally after every date.
Yeah.
Oh, and Jonathan at FHE also signs up to volunteer at Cammy's work.
Yeah, which again gives us another fun montage of him just playing games with old people.
Him being a silly guy. Ingratiating himself to everyone there except for Cammy.
Yep. Everybody loves him except Cammy.
Mm-hmm.
And she's just super bitter.
Yeah.
Yeah. She's just kind of condescending to him, like, all around.
Yeah.
Anyway.
She kind of switches pretty fast, but anyway.
Yeah. I mean, it's only a 90-minute movie, right?
Right.
So one of the next things that I wanted to talk about is one of the aspects of Mormon dating is asking a person on a date through an elaborate ruse.
Mm-hmm. Yep. I wrote that in my notes too. Yeah. Especially dances.
Especially dances. And it usually involves things like arts and crafts and puzzles and riddles and scavenger hunts and those kinds of things.
Mormons love scavenger hunts.
Yeah. And in this particular scene, Jonathan is given a big old thing of balloons, right? And he doesn't really think anything of it. He's like, whatever, just go put it over
there. They were just tied on my door.
Yeah, like, they're just trying to get me to go to another activity, blah, blah, blah. And so his friends decide to take the balloons into the back kitchen and just have some fun with them. You know, it's like it's not every day that Mormon boys get some helium to play with.
Basically, they get high on helium.
Exactly. Which I thought was kind of surprising that they would put a scene like that in there. Anyway, so while they're messing around with these balloons and getting kind of inebriated on helium.
This scene, by the way, was hilarious to me and my friends.
Really?
So funny. We talked like these guys on helium. Papa Smurf, Papa Smurf. Like that, for some reason, was hilarious. I found another piece to the puzzle. Like, it's just so...
Right. And so, okay. So they find in these balloons little pieces of... Yeah, little puzzle pieces. And so they piece it all together, and it turns out to be a note with some kind of coded message for Jonathan to meet somebody at the Hoagie Yogi so that she can ask him to the woman's preference dance or whatever.
Hmm.
And so they have this big old scene about how, you know, maybe it's Cammy. And, you know, Cammy's kind of India, but she doesn't want to, and blah, blah, blah. And like, oh, maybe it is, maybe it isn't. And so eventually he goes, and it turns out to be this, like, super high-energy girl from the ward that...
it's very goofy.
That's just super, just weird. Mm-hmm. Just way out there. Mm-hmm. But
it's still a legit stereotype.
I can think of people that at times would fit that stereotype.
So can I.
Just the sort of person that just has to prove to everybody that they are happy all the time.
I feel like there's one of these girls and one of DeVerl in almost every ward I've ever been in. singles ward or not.
Yeah. Which is especially fun when they end up hooking up. So, anyway. So it ends up not being Cammy. So he goes
to the
dance.
That's how his friends get him to go to the Hoagie Yogi. He wasn't going to go, but they're like, I bet it's Cammy.
Yeah.
What if Cammy's trying to ask you out? He's like, oh, really? You think so?
Yeah. And so he feels like a jerk saying no to this girl, so he agrees to do it, which again is another Mormon thing. Like, you don't say no to a first date.
Nope.
Even if there's absolutely no chance that you would ever pursue a relationship with this person, you don't say no to a first date.
Mm-hmm.
So they go to the dance, and Cammy's there with the Elders Quorum president, she asked, which I thought was funny, but, yeah.
She thought he was safe.
Yeah.
And he was.
And he was.
But can we talk about another stereotype real quick?
Yes.
So Mormon language. This is the scene with the balloons and stuff is where I think we get our first real taste of that.
Mm-hmm.
Like, Mormons don't swear, but they have their own substitutes for it.
Right.
And Hiram says, I think, holy fudge. Oh, my holy fudge. Because Jonathan just bought this huge TV.
Right.
Or whatever. And they talk about how TV. Awesome it's going to be to watch General Conference on this giant screen.
Which
TV.
Isn't that coming up like next week or the week after? Is this week?
I think it's actually this next weekend.
Okay. So keep your eyes peeled for that.
Usually pretty fun stuff. Oh, the last one wasn't as bad. It was a little tamed because the one before that got a lot of criticism.
It got tons of bad press last October. And we even did one of our first episodes on it.
Mm-hmm.
And then the one in April was super dialed back and just mundane, bland, just white bread, even for Mormon standards.
Yep.
So it'll be interesting to see how this one goes right before an election.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, so at the dance, I thought it was really funny, a scene that they had where one of the guys spikes the punch.
With Mountain Dew.
Oh, gosh. It's just so funny.
That the same character that spikes the punch with Mountain Dew later, his girlfriend breaks up with him, partly because she found empty Dr. Pepper cans in his car.
Yeah. And in case you're wondering if that's a bit of a stretch in Mormonism...
It's not.
It's not. My mom got really, really mad at one of my older brothers because she found empty cans of Mountain Dew in his car.
Especially at this point in time. Mm-hmm. Like, the early 2000s, like, people were still really against caffeine. Yeah. There wasn't as much leniency as there is now for drinking caffeine.
Mm-hmm.
So it's funny, but it's true. Like, it's this there. Legitimately happens.
Yeah.
Oh, you drink caffeine? I don't know if you're worthy enough to spend the rest of your life with me. You know?
It's like a comment that I read on the ex-Mormon subreddit a while back. Something to the effect, if you ever find yourself wondering if maybe the church might actually be true, just consider the fact that they propose that there are eternal consequences for drinking coffee.
Yeah.
You know, which...
But they legitimately do.
They legitimately do. And to put it into perspective for a Mormon listening to this, thinking, yeah, well, coffee's bad. It's the same... People look at the way that Mormons prohibit coffee the same way that Mormons and everybody else look at Muslims and Hasidic Jews
prohibiting
pork and not eating that ham sandwich that we talked about with Salman Rushdie. Like, that's the level of ludicrous that we're talking about.
Mm-hmm.
It's just a difference in perspective.
Right.
You know.
Yeah. It's because caffeine comes with the tag that it can be addictive.
Right.
And putting an addictive substance in your body is against the Mormon's word of wisdom.
Right.
But they don't, I don't know, like, that's the worst that caffeine does to you.
But again, going back to, like, is drinking alcohol really such a bad thing? As long as you can do it in moderation and it's not, like, causing a problem, what's the problem?
Right. Which is more or less where the church is, or the general membership has landed with caffeine. It's like, you can do it in moderation, you shouldn't find that you're reliant on the caffeine, and then it's okay. But coffee, for some reason, is still not allowed.
No.
But we don't need to get into that, because I think we've talked about that before.
We have.
Okay. So we're back on the dance. Girl's preference, right?
Yeah.
Which is just kind of weird anyway, that it's at the stake center. Like, so, my singles ward never had specific dances. They were always just stake dances. Did yours? Like, girl's pref? Like,
no.
That's a very, like, actual school-oriented dance.
Exactly. And it's... I think that they had stuff like that at BYU, but I don't remember doing anything like that with my ward or my stake.
Okay.
In fact, I don't think I ever went to a ward dance or a stake dance at BYU.
Okay.
I'm sure that they had them.
So neither one of us is the authority on whether this is a real thing or not.
No. I just I don't get the appeal of a formal dance.
Well, we talked about something like that at a restaurant a little while ago when there were a bunch of high school couples there.
Oh, yeah.
And how you said it's just kind of a relic of the past when, like, you know, when grown adults would go to, you know, fancy restaurants and dances and stuff and, just to socialize.
And teenagers would mimic that.
Yeah,
but now, like adults don't really do that. Mm-hmm. Like,
but we still hold on to this one tradition.
For the teenagers.
Yeah, for the teenagers.
It's like, it's preparing them for an aspect of our culture that has kind of died away.
Yeah, it's an unrealistic dating aspect now.
Yeah. So, to me, it's just kind of funny.
Yeah.
Just silly. Like, dance? Sure, go ahead, dance.
Yeah.
But having, like, a formal dance where you get all dressed up and gussied and,
I think that's why they do things like girls' pref and, like pajama dances and stuff like that now.
Oh.
Where they make it a little more casual.
Yeah. Anything else to say about the dance?
Let's see, we established that she was with the Elders Quorum president. He's not having a good time with his date. No, I don't think there's anything else relevant.
And wasn't there one of the guys, I think it was the blonde guy, that was like stuck dancing with a really, really large woman?
That was in the first dance scene.
Was the first dance?
Yeah. He has, he brought Jenny. This is Jenny, the girl he later marries and breaks up with him that night for the Dr. Pepper cans.
Yeah. Okay. So let's talk about that. the after party.
Yeah. So this is a typical Mormon after party,
too. Oh, it absolutely is. And so they go to Jonathan's apartment because he has this nice new TV, okay? And they're going to watch a movie called Saturday's Warrior.
Ooh, I have Saturday's Warrior on DVD! Yeah. That's Jonathan's date.
And do you want to explain what Saturday's Warrior is? I don't think we've ever actually talked about it.
I think we may have mentioned it before, but we should explain it again. So Saturday's Warrior came out in the late 70s or 80s?
Originally, it came out in the 70s.
So it's it's a play that they filmed.
A BYU play.
A BYU play that they eventually filmed and, you know, sold to Mormons. But the basic story is it starts off in the pre-existence.
Mm-hmm.
And the concept behind, I think, the story is that families are basically predestined to be together.
Yep.
And that's why Mormons continuously repopulate, because they think they have children waiting to come to Earth.
Yep.
And, I mean, that's basically the idea, right? Yep. There's one girl waiting up in heaven to come down, and then, like, all her siblings somehow affect whether or not her parents are going to get together and create her, yada, yada, yada.
Exactly.
I don't know that I've ever seen the whole thing all the way through, but that's the gist of
it. That's the summation of it.
Yeah.
And so it's just full of these just really, I would call them bad ideas.
Yeah. That a come lot of from Mormon tropes are in that, but it's not satirical at all. Like, this is serious. a serious movie.
Yeah. They have a scene where the girl or one of the kids starts to go down to get their body in their womb or whatever, and then all of a sudden the body it just disappears and they end up back in heaven.
Yeah. I thought you just went down.
Yeah. It's like, and that's the way that they depict an abortion. Mm-hmm. Like, that's what happens with abortion.
I saw a light and then suddenly I was back here.
Yeah.
Whoa. What did you just say? I'm sorry. That's been happening a lot more recently.
Right. And this was BYU's response to a counterculture movement that was going on at the time called Zero Population, where the idea of that was that the Earth was becoming overpopulated. There were too many people. So everybody needed to do the responsible thing and not have as many kids. Whereas in Mormonism, having a big family is a good thing because, as this play describes it, there are a preset number of people in each family that are predestined and preordained by God before anybody comes down to Earth and all that. And so if you don't do it, it disrupts God's plan.
Yeah, it disrupts God's plan. Mm. And by not having these children, you're denying them the opportunity to have a physical body and be tested, which is necessary for them to make it back to the celestial
kingdom.
And to be in the right family.
Yeah. Because if they don't go to the right family.
Which they also stress in that movie.
If they don't go to the right movie or the right family, they may end up being born in China or Africa or some awful place like that.
Which they point out in that movie.
Yes, exactly. So it's kind of a awful idea. But they don't end up watching that movie in this.
Because her roommate is borrowing it to prepare her Relief Society lesson.
Right.
Which just briefly touches on another stereotype in Mormon culture, that Relief Society lessons always have, like, Relief Society lessons, for some reason, are supposed to be a big to-do. Like, quite often they have elaborate, like, centerpieces. There are always, like, visuals that they use. Like, it's just, I don't know, for some reason that's a stereotype.
Okay. And so what they decide to do instead is watch God's Army.
Which is a much better decision, I think.
It's a better movie, like, overall.
Yeah.
It's a little bit more realistic. They actually tackle some of the more difficult concepts of Mormonism and Mormon doctrine and their history and stuff. Mm-hmm. They actually talk about things like blacks in the priesthood and that kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. We did a review on God's Army.
Yeah, that was, I think, the last one we did.
Yeah, it was a few episodes back. But one of the girls in this, as we pointed out, walks out because of the whole Dr. Pepper thing. Right? So there's this scene in God's Army where there's a couple of guys that are they're missionaries and they're kind of pranksters, right? And so they have this routine that they do with new missionaries to burst into the bathroom and take a picture of the new missionary while they're taking a dump. Or they're sitting on the toilet.
Except in the movie, he's not a new missionary. They're not hazing the new guy in this case. But it's just a prank.
It's just a prank that they do. And this sort of thing happens on missions. Mm-hmm. Like, as a former missionary myself, mm-hmm. I can say that this sort of thing happens. Mm-hmm. So in that regard, it was actually pretty accurate of the missionary culture at mm-hmm. that time.
Mm-hmm.
And this girl in this movie, in the singles ward, says that scene is too offensive, and she gets up and walks out of the room.
She gets up and walks out of the room because her date, Hiram, has a picture just like it in his scrapbook. That's why she gets up.
Yeah, but again, this is a legit thing. Like, people do this kind of prank, like, all mm-hmm. the time.
Yeah, but it's also legit that members were offended by this scene. Like, that's why when they have the director come in and he says, oh, I don't want to watch that movie because those bathroom right. scenes were really offensive. Like, this... like, was a legitimate criticism of that movie.
Yeah.
Even my mom even was like, why would they put that in this movie? And my dad had to explain to her that even, like, this is something that happens on missions.
Yes.
You know, he went on a mission too. He's yeah. like, we did stuff like this all the time. This yeah. is a legitimate thing.
Because they're just guys.
It's not gratuitous. Yeah.
They're just guys.
They're guys living together, and, like, they need to have some kind of release too, yeah. you know? Like, this is just something
funny.
They're
wound so tight.
Yeah. This, like, is something they can do without breaking any rules.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's just kind yeah. of inappropriate.
Yeah. Yeah.
You could make the argument that it's behavior unbecoming of a representative of the Lord,
right.
which is probably the angle that a lot of people were taking mm-hmm. in criticizing them. But
again, it's contained. They're doing it to themselves. They're yeah. not doing it to people outside of mm-hmm. that apartment.
and the reason why it's important that they even do that kind of thing is because, again, they're just young adults. They're guys. Yeah. They're living away for the first time.
Guys.
Yeah, like, they're going to do stupid things like yeah. this. They just are.
Yeah, just anyway. Funny.
And yeah, so she also gets mad about the whole Dr. Pepper can thing, and
mm-hmm.
and just leaves in a huff.
Yeah, I mean, that part happens off screen, but Hiram comes back and explains that it wasn't just the bathroom scene that right. made her leave.
Yeah, he's just a super offensive guy. Mm-hmm. He's like, I'll take it out of my scrapbook.
Yeah,
or whatever.
Right. He's like, Jenny, come back. I'll take it out of my scrapbook.
Okay, so at this after party, if you can call it that, Jonathan spills some punch in the kitchen and has to clean it up, and Cammie decides that she's going to help him
mm-hmm.
because she's a decent person.
Right.
And this gives them an opportunity to be alone, which gives them the opportunity to kiss.
Yeah, this is where the switch gets flipped for some reason.
Yeah, for some reason.
Jonathan just keeps creeping up into her space as they're, like, yelling at each other.
Right.
And then it cuts away and then cuts back and they're suddenly making out.
But that's, I mean, they do that in romantic comedies all the time.
Yeah.
Yeah. Anyway, so they end up deciding to go on a date. And
wait, we need to address the Elders Quorum president in this scene.
What about him?
Well, so he's... Jonathan, they're each going at each other's dates, right?
Okay.
Like, she, like, makes fun of his date for being, like, having terrible taste in fabric and color.
Right, because she's
and
super tacky.
He goes at mm. her date for being the type of Mormon who,
oh, right.
on every introduction, says, hi, I'm Brother So-and-so, I'm Elders Quorum President, as, you know, though, to
right.
tell you how spiritual that person actually is.
Right, which... which doesn't happen all the time, but that is a thing at
mm-hmm.
BYU. I think that most people use it as, like they just want people to be aware that that's what their calling is. If they need any help, then they should go to
right.
them, like, that kind of thing. Like, most of the time, I think that's the motivation.
Yeah,
but
I
there
agree.
Certainly is this idea within Mormonism that with these kinds of callings in the church comes a lot of responsibility, and that responsibility implies that they are well kept together, they're responsible, they're
more spiritual,
mm-hmm. you know, like it's kind of a status thing, mm-hmm. you know.
Which, I mean, this doesn't have anything to do with the movie, but it's kind of funny, like, bishops
uh-huh.
generally, I mean, being the highest in, like, the ward setting, uh-huh. like, are typically thought of as being more spiritual, but I feel like they try and counter that by saying, like, this is something that my stake president always said whenever they called a new bishop. He's like, I prayed and prayed and prayed, you know, to know who the most spiritual person in the ward was,
yeah.
and then I called her husband.
Yeah.
You know, and so they tried to offplay it by, you
yeah.
know...
the joke.
Yeah. I don't know. But yeah,
I think
trying
we talked
to come
about
off
that.
As more spiritual is pretty popular.
I think we talked about that once, and you gave the comment, then why didn't they call the wife?
Yep.
You know, like,
yeah,
why
exactly.
did it go to the husband?
It's like, if she's the most spiritual, why isn't she the conduit to God that...
right.
is better suited for the job. It doesn't
yeah.
make sense. But anyway, yeah, we did talk about that.
Yeah. Anyway, so we talked about the kiss and all that. So they go on their date, okay? Mm-hmm. And this is where we get the scene at the miniature golf course where we meet Lavelle Edwards, mm-hmm. okay?
He asks to play through.
Yeah.
On a miniature golf course.
Yeah, because...
Yeah. Because it's funny?
Because it's funny, I guess. I don't know. It's just an excuse for him to be on camera.
Yeah.
And this is where Cammy admits to Jonathan that she has put in her papers to go on a mission.
Mm-hmm.
Which means that she's going to be away for at least 18 months.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? A year and a half. And so, you know, obviously this is a blow to Jonathan. Like, he has to reconsider and, like, do I really want to pursue this? And blah, blah, blah. Like, all these things are going through his head. And she reassures him that he should still go to church so that he can spend time with her.
Yeah.
Doesn't that come in a little...
That comes in after the date, though, right?
It's... No, it's in that scene.
Okay.
She encourages him to keep going to church so that they can, like, hang out together, mm-hmm. even though she's going on a mission for 18 months, okay? Mm-hmm. And my note I put down, flirt to convert.
Yeah.
That's exactly what it is.
Yeah.
Like, she's intentionally stringing him along mm-hmm. to get him to go to church to become active again,
mm-hmm.
with no intention, at that moment at least, of pursuing a serious relationship with him.
Right.
Like, she's intentionally playing him,
mm-hmm.
you know?
Yeah. This scene, though, is also when he tells her that he was divorced,
which yeah.
we should probably touch on, especially if you're going to read comments later.
Right. And, yeah, so, I mean...
So, divorce is kind of stigmatized in the Mormon church,
mm-hmm.
and is quite often... I mean, it is looked down on. No one is ever encouraged to get divorced unless, like...
There's abuse or something.
And it has to be pretty obvious abuse.
Right.
Emotional abuse, yeah. Yeah, who cares?
You can deal with that.
You can deal with that.
Your scriptures will comfort you.
Right. So... People quite often who get divorced are kind of, I mean, they're not necessarily ostracized, but they are looked at differently because
yes.
something went wrong. And so mm-hmm. people assume that there's something wrong with that individual.
Yeah.
They don't bother to look into why the marriage fell apart,
yep.
you know, things like that. And so he has a chip on his shoulder whenever, like, this topic comes up because mm-hmm. people usually respond in that way. It's like, oh, you are now damaged good, so yep. you're not worth my time.
I can think of two examples of that in my home ward growing up. Two girls that I grew up with, okay? And let's see. So this probably would have happened around the time I got back from my mission when they were, you know, looking to get married and stuff. And one of them started dating a guy who had been married and was now a single dad. They had one kid in that marriage. And she really, really liked this guy, okay? And her dad, who was a member of the stake presidency at the time, was really trepidatious about this guy. Like, he's been divorced. Like, why is my, 19-year-old daughter trying to get involved with this guy who's been married and has a kid? Like, that mm-hmm. kind of thing. And so he like, sat down with this guy, and they had a really long, serious conversation about the whole situation. And he decided to allow them to get married because he was such a spiritual guy.
Wow.
Yeah. But the whole thing started because he was divorced.
Mm-hmm.
And so he needed to approve this guy for his daughter
mm-hmm.
so that she could marry him at the age of 19 or whatever. Mm-hmm. And they're still married. Like, they're happily married and have kids of their own and all that. Another example is a guy who I didn't really know as well. He moved into the singles ward in our area. And he was, like, a friend of a guy that was already living there, like, that kind of thing. And he had recently been divorced, and it was going through a tough situation. And he just wanted, like, to date just regular people, not really necessarily seriously. At least that's the impression that I got. And he asked out a girl that I knew. And this girl, again, because of the whole Mormon culture thing, you don't say no to a first date, said yes, even though she was uncomfortable by him. But then she got super uncomfortable about the whole situation. She complained to her parents and complained to my parents because we lived close by. And so they were looking for moral support. And, let's see. I know that her parents were there, and I am pretty sure that my dad at least was there. They waited for this guy to show up for the date to pick up this girl in the driveway. To tell him, oh, she's not interested. You need to leave.
No way.
Yeah. And at the time, my dad was the branch president of this singles ward. You know. Wow. Yeah, it's just... Yeah, just weird.
Because he was divorced?
That was the big thing. Like, wow. She was creeped out because he was divorced. I mean, maybe there's stuff about the situation that I don't know about.
Right.
That's my recollection of the situation. But at the very least, the divorce was part of the reason she didn't really like this guy.
Mm-hmm.
And was creeped out by the fact that he was hitting on her and trying to date her.
Oh, that's so sad. They waited mm-hmm. until he pulled up to the driveway to tell yeah. him that the date was off.
Yeah.
What was wrong with calling him?
This is early 2000s. Who knows if he had a cell phone? Not everybody had cell phones.
All right, but...
But still.
I mean, he's going to be at home getting ready for the date.
Yeah. Super inconvenient for that guy.
Yeah.
A total jerk move on everybody's part. You know, yeah. It just felt... And so this guy, of course, stopped going to church and all that because...
Oh, really?
Well, I wasn't directly involved in very many of the conversations and stuff, so I just got bits and pieces. I think what happened was he just decided to go to a different ward.
Well, yeah, why wouldn't you?
Yeah, exactly.
I mean, after something like that, because then word gets around and that girl's yeah. going to spread that to the other girls. Like,
yeah, exactly.
He's automatically taken off the market after something like that.
Yep. And he didn't even do anything wrong.
Yeah. Oh, that's so sad.
Yeah. Anyway, so moving back to the movie.
Yeah. Cammy takes it well.
Yeah. So Cammy gets her mission call to Australia. Finally, and she decides to go to one of Jonathan's stand-up gigs to tell him.
She's already attended. She's attended some of his gigs already, she's enjoyed them. Yeah, because mm-hmm. so like just before this, when he takes her home, they have a conversation, and he wants to go out on another date with her, but she puts the condition on that he has to go to church first.
Right.
And then he puts on another condition that says, okay, well, if I go to church, then you have to go to one of my gigs.
Right.
And so that's how he gets her to go to his shows. That's how she gets him to go to church, yada, yada, yada.
Right, because, religion is a bargaining chip.
Right. Yeah. So she goes to his shows and she mm-hmm. enjoys them. Like, there's a scene where she's laughing hysterically at his jokes.
Right. So at this particular show, mm-hmm. she goes there and she sits down and she's expecting to enjoy it and blah, blah, blah. And he's up there just bombing. Like, he's got nobody laughing at any of his jokes. She claps at one thing that he says and she's mm-hmm. like the only one, like that kind of thing.
Right. He's trying to make a joke out of cigarettes yeah. when half the population in that room is smoking.
Right.
So obviously it's not going to sit well.
Right. And so he decides to try to save himself. By appealing to his audience and making some slightly off-color jokes about Mormons.
Yeah.
Okay. And I wrote down a couple of them.
They're funny.
I wrote down a couple of them. He says that he, when he was at BYU, he studied theater, and he did a play. It was a Mormon adaptation of Seven Brides for One Brother. That's fantastic.
It
like,
is.
That's
it's
a great
funny.
Idea. And another one that he said was, I want to make an X-rated Mormon movie, but not have any sex, just guilt.
Yeah. Oh,
so okay, so these are the jokes that he's doing, okay? Mm-hmm. And she gets super offended. Like
visibly upset. Starts crying.
Yeah, she gets up and walks out of the room. He finds out that she was there, like in the parking lot, and like tries to talk to her. And she's inconsolable and basically questions his commitment to the church. And
mm-hmm.
and so they have this serious standoff moment and end up breaking up. And
yeah. Well, he tries to justify it by saying they're just jokes.
Right, which
and
they are.
Yeah, and they are just jokes. And she shoots back at him like, and that makes it okay? Like,
yes,
it makes it okay because they're jokes. And this is, like, legitimate stuff. Like, he's not making things up. Mm-hmm. Like, polygamy was a real thing.
Exactly.
Guilt is a real thing.
Yeah, especially
like, I mean,
around
I can
Mormons
see
and
how
sex.
That, yeah, I can mm-hmm. see how that one would be a little bit offensive to Mormons. But uh-huh. at the same time, like, it shouldn't be because it's a real thing.
Right.
Like, these aren't things that he's fabricating for his enjoyment.
Yeah, so...
And then he also brings, like, they get into it, yada, and he's like... He blames his bad marriage on the church because he did things because of the expectations that the church put on him.
Right.
And
going
she,
back to what
yeah.
you said in the beginning.
Yeah. yeah. And she, you know, shoots back. Don't you dare blame your bad marriage on the church.
Right.
But it is kind of
Exactly.
That, I mean, he like they got set married up... because he was supposed to get married.
Exactly.
He
they found set up a the woman, expectation.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. He found a woman that he probably legitimately could have had a good relationship with, except that he made her convert,
mm-hmm.
which is something that the church really stresses.
Right.
You need to marry a member.
Yep.
Marrying a non-member puts undue stress on the relationship. And it does,
which
but it
is
shouldn't.
True. Yeah. It's true that it does, but mm-hmm. as you point out, it shouldn't. And the reason it shouldn't is because Mormons do something that they shouldn't in trying to convert the other person, you know?
Mm-hmm.
If, like, Mormons they have a very hard time in being in a close relationship with somebody and not pushing their religion on somebody.
Yeah.
On that person.
Mm-hmm. Even if they don't realize that they're doing it.
Yeah. Exactly. And it puts a lot of strain. That shouldn't even be there.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, so anything else to say about their argument? I didn't write a whole lot down about it.
I don't think so. Oh, well, she does point out that she had been praying to, you know, asking God if going on a mission was what she was actually supposed to be doing,
mm-hmm.
implying that she was considering Jonathan as an eternal partner.
Right.
You know, is my path now going down this way? Should I stay and get married?
Right, which is, again, is a thing that happens. You know.
Yeah, it is a thing that happens, but it's also a really popular thing that happens with Mormon women
yep.
that are going on missions,
yep.
which kind of comes up a little bit later with another character.
Mm-hmm.
But, I mean, we don't have to talk about that right now.
Okay, so after they break up, we get this long montage.
Another montage.
Yeah, but this one's a long one.
Yeah, this one's
long. And there were a few funny moments in it. But it's basically just Jonathan going on tour to do stand-up, and after some of his gigs, he hooks up with some girls and has a couple drinks and blah, blah, blah. And the flip side of that, of course, is Cammy being a good pre-Mormon missionary, right?
Getting ready for a mission.
Getting ready for a mission, reading scriptures, speaking in church, wearing modest clothing.
Mm-hmm. And a lovely pearl necklace.
I missed that. And then the montage ends with Jonathan coming back to Provo just after Cammy leaves for the MTC. Okay, so they miss each other. And he decides...
Technically, they're in the same city.
Yes, but the MTC is a lockdown facility.
Yes. Like, it's just literally. Funny. Like, he could still legitimately see her. Like, he could just wait on the street corner on P-Day or whatever, you know. Or when she's going to the temple.
I was just going to say, like, the MTC is legitimately a lockdown facility.
Yeah.
Like people have a really hard time getting out of the building
mm-hmm.
Because the doors close and lock at certain hours and stuff. Mm-hmm. Like, they literally lock you in. Anyway, so when he gets back, he does a show in Salt Lake, okay? And he hooks up with this bartender that he's kind of flirted with a little bit in the past.
She's very obviously flirted with him.
Yes.
Asks on multiple occasions when she can get a private gig.
Yeah. And we know that this bartender is a bad person because she smokes and wears skimpy clothing. And she wears spaghetti strap tank tops. Mm-hmm. That's how we know she's a bad person. So they go to her place, and just as they are starting to fool around a little bit, and they're about to drink some beer, Jonathan looks out the window, and what does he see?
The Salt Lake Temple.
The Salt Lake Temple.
He has to open the blinds. That's what's funny.
And so he gets this big shot, you know, of him staring at the Salt Lake Temple.
Yeah.
And he decides that he just can't go through with it.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. He just can't fool around with this super hot spaghetti strapped girl with a beer.
Mm-hmm.
And she questions him. She's like, what are you, Mr. Morality now? And like, why do you go to a church that tells you what to do?
Right.
Like, those are a couple of the things that she says. And his response is, it's my choice.
Mm-hmm. Because that's something that Cammy told him.
Right.
It's like, you don't, the church isn't making you do things. It's your choice to do these things.
Which on some level is true, but there is a ton of pressure to do it.
Yeah. There's an obvious bias to which way you're supposed to go.
Right.
And if
exactly.
you don't go that way,
you're a bad person.
People treat you differently.
Yeah. Like this
obviously
girl.
Different.
Like we're supposed to assume that this girl, because she smokes drinks and has a tank top on, that she's a bad person.
And subtly implies that she has no morals.
Exactly.
Because she does those things.
Yep.
Like
exactly. That's exactly what's implied by her saying, what are you, Mr. Morality now?
Yeah.
Like, because, and this is a note that I wrote down, right, because drinking beer and adults having consensual sex is so immoral, and we totally need a modern church based on Bronze Age superstition to tell us what's right and wrong.
Yep.
You know, it's like, like, these aren't necessarily bad things. Like, they can, I suppose, lead to bad things, but Yeah. Anyway. Mm-hmm. So he storms off and has this little spiritual journey thing in his car, another montage. And, it, you know, it's complete with sappy religious pop songs. And during all of this, he comes to the realization that the church is true. Because warm fuzzies totally equal God talking to you.
Well, he remembers all the very, like milestone moments in, you know, a lifetime church member's life. Like, of leading into the church. Like, the first clip is of him getting baptized. The second one is of him receiving the priesthood and being, you know, blessed by his dad. The second one is his first time passing the sacrament.
Right.
You know, and the next one is him on his mission. Like, these are all milestone moments in a person's life. And so, yeah, they're going to come with that warm, fuzzy feeling because they're supposed to.
Right. You've been programmed to associate that.
Yeah, exactly.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And he starts to explain, like, the method for his reconversion. Like, he does, like, the whole looking at the camera thing that they kind of make fun of a little bit later. But just before he gets to the point where he actually explains what changed his mind, what really convinced him that the church is true, he gets interrupted. And they don't actually address it.
Mm-hmm.
But the implication is that Mormonism is true because when you think about it, when you pray about it, when you read the scriptures, you feel good about it, mm-hmm. and that means God is telling you that it's true.
Mm-hmm. Okay? They also address the whole idea of like the conversion moment, like not having concourses of angels come down,
mm-hmm.
because a lot of people like compare their testimonies maybe to like Joseph Smith having angels come down and telling him that this was the only true church and he needed to establish it.
Right.
And so people quite often like will say, well, I've never had an experience like that. So mm-hmm. I don't know that the church is true. So this is their way of addressing like concourses of angels aren't going to come down. Like it affects people differently, but you still need to make the effort.
Yeah. Well, there are a few, you know, scriptures in the Book of Mormon, you know, don't seek a sign, don't tempt God, don't mm-hmm. test God, like those kinds of things that Mormons will point to and saying, you know, angels coming down isn't going to convince you. Look at Laman and Lemuel. Like, they saw an angel and they still tried to kill Nephi and like that kind of stuff.
Which realistically probably isn't accurate.
Right. But it's their way of saying, you know, even if God sent an angel, you wouldn't be convinced by it. Mm-hmm. It's like, well, it's more convincing than warm fuzzies.
Right.
You know?
That could be confused with something else.
Right, like say an emotion.
Ate a nice bowl of soup.
Yeah. Or maybe your burning desire that it's true.
Right.
You know?
Or the burning desire to be on the same page as everyone else.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. Like, do some research into cognitive bias and psychological conditioning, and all of a sudden the whole Mormon conversion thing makes a whole lot more sense. Anyway, so Jonathan is reconverted. I guess in this moment finds out that Cammy is about to ship off for Australia.
Mm-hmm.
So she's on her way to the airport. Okay. So he goes to the airport, tracks her down, and proposes.
Keep in mind, he's in Provo. Uh-huh. The airport is in Salt Lake, and he has 20 minutes before her flight leaves to get there.
Which is funny. Yeah.
Impossible. He's not going to make that.
No, it's at least 30 to 40 minutes.
And that's if there's no traffic.
And that's with no traffic. Anyway, so, but you know, it's funny. It's a trope, blah, blah, blah. So he gets there. He proposes, says that he loves her, all that stuff. And her response is she gives him a hug.
Yes. He admits that he loves her. She says, I love you too, but I need to do this for me. Hugs him and says,
goodbye.
Yeah. It's like, you're not doing... Well, I mean, she's kind of implying you're not doing this for the right reason. You need some time to yourself too to rediscover who you are.
Right.
And I need to do this, so I'm going to hug you.
Yeah.
Are sister missionaries allowed to touch men?
They have the same restrictions. That's what I thought. Yeah.
Because like in my notes, I'm like, oh my gosh, she just broke a missionary code and touched a man.
Yeah, exactly. Like, that's what I was... Yeah,
in
that's
front
what I was
of people.
At. In front of other missionaries.
Yeah.
Yeah, and that
and no
really,
one reacts.
And that really nosy old guy behind them just, you know, whatever. It's cool.
If you really want to get married, you should try one of those singles wards.
Yeah, that guy. Anyway, so the end of the movie happens really, really fast. Like, I'm fairly certain that I missed parts of it. But basically, she comes back from her mission. They get married, and they end with them giving joint talks and sacrament meeting. Which to me was totally anticlimactic and implies that going on a mission will always is always the right choice, and your life will always work out as long as you go on a mission.
I guess you can get that.
Yeah.
I mean, it goes, you know, black and says one mission later.
Mm-hmm.
And which is kind of misleading because you assume that since Cammy's the one that left, it's Cammy is the one that's coming back, but it ends up being Dallin that comes back from his mission.
Right. And Cammy and Jonathan are already married when
we re-meet all of the friends. Like, Hiram is there with his, like, with his new wife.
Uh-huh.
And Eldon is there with his wife who is pregnant.
Yeah.
And, like, Jonathan makes the joke, you guys need to hurry up.
Right.
So you can catch up with these two.
Yep.
And then Hiram's wife is like, oh, that's so silly. Just give us a couple weeks and then we'll really start trying sort of thing. It's like, oh my gosh. Like,
we're still learning what genitals
are. Yeah, they're newlyweds. And she says, give us a couple weeks. It's like, and that's accurate better. Too. It's like people like immediately after getting married, they start procreating.
Yep, exactly. Because again, Mormons don't really like contraception either.
Yeah.
And there's a lot of importance placed on having kids as soon as you can.
Yeah.
Because again, going back to the Saturday's Warrior thing, they take that seriously.
Yes.
They think that there are children waiting for them to start procreating.
Yeah. And I guess thinking about it, Eldon and his wife would have had to start procreating really quick too. Since this is like, I mean, we don't really have a solid timeline, but Dallin had probably been out on his mission for at least 6 months by the time Eldon and his wife got married. And she's about to pop. So, you know, that's a really quick courtship for one thing, and then they get pregnant.
Yeah, exactly. But again, that's the thing that happens at BYU.
Yeah,
that's what they're making fun of.
Yeah, it's accurate. It's an accurate portrayal of what happens.
Mm. And then we get more...
Oh, and Jonathan's life has changed even more because now he's a writer. He doesn't do stand-up anymore.
Yes, and he's the Elders Quorum president, which is super ironic. He's the
Elders Quorum president.
Yeah, so take that.
Yes. Full circle.
Full circle. Now he's the pretentious Elders Quorum president.
Yes.
Yeah. And, yeah, anyway.
And that's how it ends.
And then we get the scrapbook end credits.
Yes.
Because that's what Mormons consider an acceptable pastime.
And the person doing the end credits is listening to all this music on their Walkman or Discman. Did you notice that?
Oh, yeah. okay, so I wrote down a few notes, kind of my thoughts on the whole thing.
Okay.
And then we'll get to some of the comments on IMDb.
Okay.
Yeah. Anyway, so here's what I wrote down as my thoughts at the end of the movie. The entire movie centers around the idea that singles wards in the church, and especially at BYU, help people become their best selves. Without a spouse, they're incomplete human beings, unworthy of the most awesome of God's blessings in this life and the next. Add to this concept the condemnation of any sexual activity outside of marriage, even masturbation, and a rising average marriage age, even at BYU. And you have a recipe for people getting married and having kids super fast, often without knowing anything about the other person. This is a more effective method of growing the church than any amount of door-to-door religious sales reps trying to convert the uninterested. Seriously. Missionary work is a generally fruitless and futile endeavor, locking young couples into marriage with children, promising them an eternal family in heaven, and occupying their time with frivolous weekly and daily church activities so they are too busy to realize how ridiculous their beliefs are, or how many historical problems the church has, or even how factually inaccurate their own holy book is a tried and true method of convincing well-intentioned people to give the church 10% of their money until the day they die. As much fun as it is to laugh and lampoon Mormons for their quirkiness, this is their true power, and it is as dangerous as it is immoral.
Right, yeah. That's quite the thought.
Yeah. So those are my closing remarks. And do you have anything else to add to that?
I think that covers lots of stuff. But singles wards... Okay, so my... Singles wards to me, I mean, they really are just meat markets. That's how they're described. And I think that's part of the reason why they made this movie, because that's how people approach it.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it really is just a meat market. People legitimately use the ward handbook to flip through and find people to date and potentially marry.
Yeah.
Like, that's why they have photos in them. Like, a typical ward handbook does not have photos in them, but you get them in a singles ward, and everyone has to get their picture taken. Everyone's yep. picture gets put in the ward handbook, mm-hmm. and every person gets a ward handbook.
Yep. Like I still have one of mine.
Oh, really?
Yeah. I have a digital copy of it.
Oh, that's funny.
Yeah. I flip through it sometimes just to reminisce and kind of laugh at it. Cause it's just funny.
Yeah.
Anyway. Anything else?
Nope.
Okay. So on the IMDb page, I said that right, didn't I?
IMDb page, yes.
IMDb page. They have, the standard forum or whatever, and there's quite a few comments from members and former members and people just kind of, you know, going at it. And some people commenting on how accurate it is, and some people commenting on how inaccurate it is. And one guy, who goes by the name Will7370, comments on how irreverent it is.
The music is, right?
Well, he has a couple of posts. One is about the music, and the other one is about how Cammy can do better.
Mm-hmm.
So I just wanted to read them, because they really do offer an insight on another aspect of Mormon culture, viewing movies like this.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like, there are people who really don't like movies like this making fun of Mormonism, because Mormonism is super serious,
mm-hmm.
as this guy illustrates.
Mm-hmm.
So I just wanted to read some of the stuff he said. Does anyone else think that Cammy married far below her spiritual potential by marrying Jonathan when she got back from her mission? Even though he did sort of get his life together there towards the end, the fact that he was worldly oriented to begin with, not to mention being divorced, should have raised red flags all over for her. She seemed to take the gospel and the commandments much more seriously than he did. She could have been setting herself up for a mighty big letdown someday. I guess you could argue that he had repented, in quotes, but then should a prospective marriage partner never pay attention to a person's past when they claim to be repentant? What if he had been divorced 3 times and accused of molesting kids? How much do you ignore? I think Cammy could have done much better for herself.
Oh my gosh. Well, the molesting kids thing you don't ignore.
Right.
And if a person has been divorced 3 times, yeah, maybe you pause a second and try and figure out why that person got divorced 3 times. But
right.
That shouldn't be a reason not to pursue a relationship.
Right.
That's funny.
And so it just turned. Awful. It just kind of spiraled into this big argument of him being judgmental and him just continuing to, you know, bury himself into a deeper and deeper hole about how bad a person Jonathan is.
Wow.
And how Cammy shouldn't have married him.
Interesting.
Another one, this one's a little bit longer. I'll probably skip some of it. This one's about the music. Does anyone else find it troublesome to hear irreverent versions of sacred songs in this film, particularly the hymns of the Restoration? There are some things you just don't do, and one of these is taking the sacred and bringing it down to the level of the world. How would people like it if we built a likeness of one of our sacred temples and turned it into a comedy club? Or perhaps a rap studio? At this point, I kind of wondered if this person might be, like, pulling our leg, like being a troll or something. But no, this guy, like, reading, like, more of his comments, he's totally legit in saying this stuff, okay? Which just makes that part even funnier. Or what if someone showed up at a costume party, I love this part, with a President Hinckley mask, dressed in just a Speedo.
Oh my God, please.
Okay, again, this guy's totally serious about this, okay?
You do Hinckley, and I'll do his wife.
Yeah. some things are just downright offensive to the spirit, and I think those who make a mock of the sacred will one day have to answer to our Heavenly Father. He's calling to repentance the makers of this film.
Okay.
Instead of bringing the sacred down to the level of Babylon, code words, why not try to elevate the world up to the level of the sacred? Why do we need to stoop to the level of the world to be entertained? I did not find it very funny to find two fellows in this movie inhaling helium at wild swinging camera angles while a distorted version of one of our dear primary songs was being played in the background. Your favorite scene. The drug use imagery was only too apparent. Do we find this uplifting? Does anyone really think we will be spiritually prepared for the return of the Savior or the descent of Enoch's Zion? When we have been so irreverent in mocking sacred things. I love that he references Enoch's city. Because in Mormon culture, they believe that the city of Enoch, the entire city, was lifted, dirt and all, to heaven.
Right.
Okay.
Is that not a common belief with other Christians?
I don't know if other religions believe that.
Because I always thought it was just a little, like, people... thought it was a little
thing. Maybe it is, but Mormons like talking about it because one of the ways that they know that the second coming will be here, that Jesus will be here for his grand return, right, is that the city of Enoch will come back to the plot of land and just be put back into the dirt. If this stuff is so okay, then why don't they play this stuff in our temples? If you only knew... Because
it wasn't made for that. Oh my gosh, this guy completely misses the point.
If you only knew the depth to which a person can be in tune with the Spirit, you would lay these things aside forevermore. Call me a prude if you want to.
You are a prude.
I'm speaking the truth, and you know it deep down inside.
Trying to call people out, huh?
Yeah, he is. He's calling people to repentance. It's interesting. Like, a lot of people call him out on the whole idea of playing these songs in the temples and how inappropriate they would be. And they bring, you know, some interesting ideas in like the whole conversation. It's probably worth reading. But my mind thought, would you be commenting on a forum on an IMDb page in the temple?
Would you say that again?
So, in response to this guy saying that you wouldn't play the music of this movie in the temple, I would say, would you be on a forum for an IMDb page in the temple? Would you do that in the temple?
No.
Then this guy is a complete hypocrite. He's saying that you should only do things that are appropriate to do in the temple.
Oh.
That's what he's saying.
Oh, okay.
Like, he's saying that we should strive for a level of spirituality, that we only do things that are appropriate to do in the temple, and we do that in our everyday life. That's the only thing that you should ever do, is stuff that's appropriate to do in the temple. Okay. And here he is on an IMDb page commenting on a movie. Okay. Would he do that in the temple?
Okay.
If not, he is a hypocrite.
Okay.
You know, that's what I'm saying.
That's what you're saying now.
Yeah.
I got it.
Anyway. Anything else to add? Or to say.
No.
Or to imply.
This was the last good Mormon movie.
Yeah, I thought it was funny that they had Richard Dutcher make a cameo in here because he didn't like this movie. And he thought that this type of movie dumbed down Mormon cinema.
Well, when he made the cameo, he didn't know what they were going for.
I suppose that's true, but it's still funny to me that he would badmouth it afterwards.
Anyway. And it did. It completely changed the direction that Mormon cinema went.
Yeah, because he did very serious movies.
Yeah.
God's
Army. That
brought
up legitimate, like, arguments, criticisms, and concerns within the
And he Mormon still community. He still wants to do a Joseph Smith movie.
I would love that.
Which is especially interesting now that he's been out of the church for a number of years.
Yeah.
So his perspective on what Joseph Smith, what he did and what his history was, would be really intriguing, I think.
Mm-hmm.
But he'll never get the rights from the church to do it, I don't think.
Would he need the rights? I mean, Joseph Smith is a public figure.
Maybe.
He could potentially make... I mean, his biggest hindrance right now is getting the funding for it.
I guess that's true. Maybe I don't know what I'm talking about.
Right, because before when he was trying to make the movie, he was trying to go through church channels. But I think if he went through... other channels, like if he appealed to the ex-Mormon community, I think he could probably get some funding for it.
Yeah. Well, I mean, he'd have to find some pretty well-to-do ex-Mormons that were interested in such a project.
Right, but I mean, he, like, the way he's funded a lot of his other movies have been through Kickstarter. And, like,
oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah, I mean, all of his stuff, like, he either self-funds or gets funding from donations through, you know, things like Kickstarter. And so, like, I think if he did something like that and, like, started with the ex-Mormon community, I think eventually he could get the money to actually make this production.
Yeah. I would love it.
I would love it, too.
I would love to see his perspective.
Yeah.
I would love to see his perspective on Mormon church history.
Mm-hmm. If he made it here, I would even volunteer to help make it. I think it'd be awesome.
I was almost in a Mormon movie once.
Really?
Yeah. In one of my biology classes at BYU, they had a sign-up list for the Mormon version of Pride and Prejudice. And I almost...
Oh, yeah!
I almost went to it.
You should have. That one's...
I should have.
That one's less obviously Mormon.
Yeah.
But, yeah. It's got some Mormon bits in it. That's funny.
I almost did it. It was just a little too early for me to commit for a Saturday. Yeah. Anyway. Anything else?
No.
All right. Good. I think that's a good place to end. Good. So that's our show.
Thanks for listening.
If you would like to contact us, you can email us at skepticsquaredpodcast@gmail.com. And our blog is at www.skepticsquaredpodcast.blogspot.com, which is a hard thing for me to remember sometimes after not recording for a while. We'll see you next time on the Skeptic Squared Podcast.